Today we have a guest lecture from my friend and former colleague, Dr. Neeraj Jha. Neeraj is presently a senior engineer at JK Tires, the tire mechanics group in the JK Tire Tech Center at Hasetri. This is in Mysore in India. And he has been working there since 2018. Before that, he got a PhD from Hanover, where both of us met. He was working at IBM with Professor Nakenhorst. And after that, he had a stint of postdoctoral research at University of Seville. And even before, he had worked for 4 years in MSIL research and development before his PhD as well. As far as I know, both of us had the same kind of a project for our PhD. We were funded through Continental, where we were working on tire and tire-related research. And he's a specialist in the area of finite element technology, noise and vibrations, multi-body dynamics, mechanics of cord reinforced rubber systems. You can see there are several papers of his on cord reinforced rubbers and damage in these materials and homogenization and multi-scaling as well. He has made research, quite a lot of research contributions into this area of constitutive modeling, of particularly in rubber materials, and looked at the computation mechanics aspects of these materials. And he has published more than 10 journal articles so far, and also a fellow of SAE Society and American Chemical Society. I would like to welcome him, and I would like to thank him for accepting the invitation to speak to us today. He'll be talking to us about UMAT routines and how to write a UMAT routine for Abacus. We are also planning another lecture in the future where he'll be discussing UEL, but today we'll be restricting particularly to how to write a UMAT, what does a UMAT mean, what are the issues that are there related to the, let's say, writing a UMAT, and how to get it running with Abacus as well. What do you need to do? Do you need to get a compiler? How do you need to install this compiler and things like that? I mean, I wouldn't go on about giving the lecture myself. I think I should give the giveaway to Neeraj to take over from here. Thank you very much, Neeraj, for joining us, and the floor is yours.
Yeah, thank you, Ajay, for giving the nice introduction. So as he already mentioned that we were together in Hanover, and we also organized one conference in Hanover, Research Challenges in Mechanics, together in 2017. And we worked in a similar area and with the similar funding party in Hanover, Continental. So we know each other since last, I guess, 5-6 years. And yeah. Our friendship is continued. Okay. So now I will start the UMAT introductions. So I guess whoever is using the Abacus, probably they already know that UMAT is something like a user material where you can embed your own constitutive model in a particular format that Abacus can accept, and you can define the stress and tangent stiffness. So that we will be talking about, and also I will give you some hint that how you can include some failure mechanisms, mainly in terms of continuum damage mechanics, because if you want to introduce some fatigue failures or some crack growth, then you have to go to UEL instead of UMAT. So that requires much more advanced method of modeling these user routines. So we will stick to the basic modeling of UMAT, and I will start with the motivation. If you have any questions, you can write it in the chat box. We can discuss it at the end of the presentation. Hope that is fine to everyone. So this UMAT, we actually started writing during the time of PhD, because my doctoral thesis was mainly into this constitutive modeling of quad reinforced systems.
Sorry, Neeraj, 1 minute. Your voice is low. Can it be possible to increase your volume, audio volume, or you can speak a bit louder or closer to your mic?
I can do that.
Yeah, thanks a lot.
So now it is better?
Excellent. Good.
Okay, fine. So we'll start with the motivation, and then why you need to introduce the constitutive modeling into Abacus. And then I will be talking about the hyperelastic material behavior, consistent tangent modulus. Then we will introduce the damage laws into the constitutive model. and I will explain some numerical results. And then after the presentation, I will show you one demonstration of how to run UMAT with Abacus for the beginners. And also I will demonstrate how you should read the variables, because that is very important. Because if you mismatch what Abacus wants and what you want, then there is always some error and some tolerance will be there, and then that will lead to the convergence issues that also we will discuss, that how to avoid those convergence problems. Okay, so my PhD was mainly into the failure of quad reinforced systems. As you can see the first picture here, as you can see, this one is the rubber air spring. This is used in suspension system in, you can say, high-end cars, Audi or BMW, where Continental is supplier. So such failure occurs. As you can see, thread, the cord came out. In the second image, as you can see that the rubber layer has been failed. In the third, you can see that the kind of delamination, we call, where the cord rubber adhesion has been lost. And in the fourth image here, you can also see some rubber failure mechanism. So the cord is embedded into the rubber system, and that is why we are calling that as cord reinforced system. And more or less, tire also has the same sort of models. And usually you go for rebar sort of techniques, which is available in Abacus. So we will not go into the rebar formulations and other things now. We will be only talking about how can you assess some damage mechanism like that in a continuum sense, not as a fracture or crack mechanism. Okay. So as you know that there are several commercial packages available nowadays, ANSYS, Abacus, and these are the major finite element solver used in industry, aerospace and automobile industry. And I performed Abacus, all the simulations in Abacus UMAT. So I will be talking about how you can deal or how can you write UMAT specifically in Abacus commercial solver. Okay, so as the name indicates, UMAT is nothing but a user material that on the constitutive model that you are supplying to Abacus in a particular format, in a particular variable sense that Abacus can understand. Okay, there is one more advanced routine associated with Abacus, that is UEL, that is Abacus user element, which is much more advanced. There you need to write the complete element, not only the material, but the complete element. So you need to define the element Jacobian, not the material Jacobian. And UEL basically integrates the UMAT also. Okay. So UEL is much advanced. That maybe if future, if we conduct some lecture, then probably we will be talking about some complex element routines. That also I wrote one of the model, the gradient enhanced damage model. So there you can play with the nodal variables and you can introduce multiphysics capability into the new element. Okay. But the advantage with UMAT is that you are using the element from the Abacus. Only what you are changing is the material constitutive laws. So that is much easy to handle, because writing UEL is not so easy, and convergence is sometimes is a big problem. Okay. So how you integrate the element data with UMAT is one of the first step, that you should have an input file, INP, or you should have a parametric file, which is PES, and you can pass the UMAT with this INP. And in this INP, you have to define the user material instead of inbuilt material with some properties. Props 1, props 2, maybe depending on what are all the variables that you have or the constructive properties of the materials that you have. And that way you can allow the UMAT to read to the Abacus. So that we will see in one of the examples. Okay. So if you have any question, you can type in the chat box. We will discuss at the end of the presentation or during the demonstration part. Okay, starting with the fundamental things. So one key point while writing is while writing the UMAT in Abacus is Abacus reads everything in UMAT as a current configuration. As you can see, the left is nothing but your reference configuration and the right is your current configuration B tau. So you have to pass your tangent stiffness in the current configuration, also stress in current configuration. So the Cauchy stress and the tangent stiffness, which is written in the push forward sense. Okay. So that also we will see how we will write that. And the concept behind all these laws, as you know, it starts with the deformation gradient, which is nothing but the displacement gradient plus unity tensor. And then with that, you try to construct your, let us say, strain variables like left Cauchy-Green tensor or right Cauchy-Green tensor. And with that, you derive your second Piola. Then second Piola, you can transform that to the current configuration as a Cauchy stress. And then all the variables that you can construct in the hyperelastic, you can use deformation gradient as one of the primary variables. And that is the most important point that you should know. So for hyperelastic material, your F is the primary variable and you will write everything with respect to F. Even the your free energy and then your stress and then your tangent stiffness. And it has to satisfy, as you know, it has to satisfy some balance laws like first law of thermodynamics, second law of thermodynamics to for the validity in terms of consistency in terms of entropic inequality. Okay. Going further. So let us say we have a free energy psi, okay? Either you can write as strain energy density form or you can write as strain energy. It is a function of primary variable, as you can see, F. And you can play with additional internal variable, let us say alpha. You can call that as damage, okay? Either you can write as alpha or any function of alpha, which alpha is nothing but your internal variable. Could be damage, could be any thermal loss, whatever is depending on your constitutive style that you are going to impose. And you can decompose this free energy into two form. One is the volumetric part of free energy and another part is the isochoric part of free energy. And then you assume that your constitutive model, your damage affects only the isochoric part. You can bring this psi alpha to complete volumetric sense as well. But for this particular UMAT, we are assuming that your damage loss is only affecting the isochoric part of free energy. Okay. And then you can have any sort of phenomenological free energies, as you know, popularly a new Hookean, which is very simple to use. That is why it's used in most of the tire industry or even in different rubber automobile industry. Then you can have another version of free energy, Mooney-Rivlin, yaw, Ogden. You can include anything you want, but again, if you complex your material laws, then your convergence is a problem. Another thing is the parameter identification of those complex model is a problem, okay? So once you have free energy, you take the derivative of free energy with respect to right Cauchy-Green tensor, you obtain the second Piola as 2 dou psi by dou c. And then with second Piola, you transform that to the current configuration and you obtain the Cauchy stress sigma, which can be a function of, let us say, strain. Here you can put E, capital E, which is a Green Lagrange strain. And alpha is nothing but your internal variable. So this is taken from a textbook, Peter Hoft, the continuum mechanics and theory of materials. This is to demonstrate that a material can have different sort of responses The most simplest one is elastic or hyperelastic, you can call that. Simplistic rubber material which does not dissipate any energy. The second could be elastoplastic, that if there is some sort of reinforcement in the rubber, let us say some sort of particles in form of you can call some compounding related, which can exhibit some sort of plasticity, then you can have response like elastoplastic. Then another is viscoelastic, where you can say when you load and unload the material, then there is a loss, there will be hysteresis. And this hysteresis again is a questionable thing, because it can be amplitude dependent, it can be time dependent. There are several laws. You can follow the paper of Alexander Leon from TU Munich. There are several laws related to viscoelastic models. Some of them exhibit pain effect, some of them exhibit Mullins effect. So you can refer all this. And then there could be another complexity is elasto-viscoplastic, which exhibit both elastic in nature, viscous in nature, and plastic in nature. So this all complexity, you can bring that into the UMAT, and depending on the constitutive model that you choose, but definitely you can model these four materials into UMAT. Okay, so we started the slides with the motivation that I had a failure in my continuum and I wanted to assess that continuum. So to assess that, the easiest way is to embed some sort of fracture. So in a mathematical sense, we are in a continuum scale, so we have to write everything in terms of mathematical relations. So as you can see here, we are writing the diffuse field variable, a crack in terms of an exponential function. And the feature of this exponential function is that you can control the width of this crack with the variable zeta. Okay, you can change the zeta and you can make that crack as a sharp crack or a diffuse crack of a finite width, depending on the model that you develop. Okay, so let us start our the main thing that we are talking about today, the constitutive model for new hook, let us say. And I choose a very specific form of free energy, which is already inbuilt in Abacus, so that you can compare this UMAT with the Abacus results. Okay, so here is mu by 2 trace of B bar minus 3, where B bar is nothing but coming from your left Cauchy green tensor, which is left Cauchy strain tensor. Okay, and J is nothing but Jacobian of deformation gradient, which is nothing but determinant of F. And mu and kappa, these are the constitutive variables, so shear modulus and coming from the bulk modulus. So now we have only two variables, mu and kappa. This is nothing but your constitutive variables. And B bar, J, and everything, as I said, you have to obtain from deformation gradient F. Okay. So once you take the derivative of psi, this psi NH with respect to C, and then you take that in a push forward sense and you write Kirchhoff stress, it takes particularly this form. Okay. And then you have to obtain the Cauchy stress as tau by J. So you can do this as an exercise. Just take the derivative of new Hookean free energy with respect to, let us say, right Cauchy or left Cauchy, and then you derive the stress. So you should be getting something like this. Okay, now coming to the fourth order elasticity tensor. So that is where most of us have a problem while writing the UMAT, because it has to be consistent enough. Otherwise, you will always have convergence issues. Okay, so in this particular UMAT lecture and also during my PhD thesis, I followed the tangent stiffness linear in a linearized sense, detailed in a book written by J.C. Simo, Computational Inelasticity. So you can refer that. And here I can tell you what are the parameters which affect the tangent stiffness. So the first thing you should notice that in this slide, what we have done, we have split the energy into two forms. So one is the volumetric form, other is your isochoric form. So of course, when you take the derivative, then you will have two stresses. One is coming from this isochoric part of free energy, another coming from the volumetric part of free energy. So once you have two value of stresses, when you take the derivative of those stresses to obtain the tangent stiffness, then you will have two tangent stiffness. One is coming from the volumetric part, which is this term, and another is coming from the isochoric part, which is this term. Okay. So I am detailing here the terms which are already in a linearized sense detailed in the textbook by J.C. Simo, Computational Inelasticity. So you should see that how it was linearized properly. And then if you have any questions, you can always come back to me or Ajay. So this is the term. So you have to take the double derivative of volumetric energy with respect to J. And this is the first derivative of volumetric free energy with respect to J. One is your identity tensor, and this capital I is fourth order identity tensor. Okay. And C iso has six terms. So this T1 is, as you can see, Fi bar is four times forwarded. So it's because you start mainly from the reference configuration and you go to the current configuration. So if you have done some course in continuum mechanics, you know that when you have a S, let us say as a second Euler stress, you can transform S to the stress in the current configuration as FSF transpose. Okay. So for stress quantity, you are doing F times something into F transpose. So in the tangent stiffness, it will be done twice. So that is why you have four terms here. Okay. And T2 is coming from, again, the derivative of free energy, which is isochoric. And E is nothing but your Green Lagrange strain. So I can type the expression of Green Lagrange so that I think it's half of C minus I. So you can see that in my UMAT that how I have coded the Green Lagrange and all these quantities. Then T3, the terms again, and these are fourth order tensor, as you should be noticing that. So it's your one third of coming from identity tensor and this term, which is second order tensor. Then T4, again, you can see that this has shifted this side. So this term coming from, the isochoric part of free energy, and this is an identity tensor. Okay. And T5 and T6, these are the terms related to coming from the stress. Okay. So you add everything in a consistent manner, and one additional term is required, which we call as Yaumann rate, because that is the requirement when you do the rigid body rotations. So that Abacus prefers to have this in tangent stiffness. So again, you have to add this term, right? So if you add all these terms consistently following this, all the linearized term, then you should have a consistent Jacobian. And you can see all this, whether your Jacobian is consistent or not. When you run the model in Abacus, you generate the message file. And in the message file, you can see how your tolerance is changing. Okay. And you can compute the error and plot this error. You can see whether this is quadratic or not. If not, if it is linear or if it is too slow, if it is taking a lot of steps, that means something is wrong in your constitutive. Okay. So the key area here is first point that you have to define your volumetric energy, and then you have to define your isochoric energy consistently, obtain the stress, obtain the tangent stiffness following these formulas, and the linearization of these formulas are given in the textbook by Simo, and then you have to code it in this manner, and then you have to run this user material. So that I will explain with my UMAT file in some time. Okay. Another complexity in Abacus is the way it codes the stress. Okay, so stress is read as your vector in folk notation, and usually in our engineering or in most of the Indian textbooks or some of the foreign authors' textbook, if you notice that the 2-3 component comes in this side, so it is like sigma 1-1, 2-2, 3-3, then 1-2, 2-3, and 1-3. But Abacus is having this notation, so 2-3 is coming in the last. So similarly, you should notice that your tangent stiffness matrix, which is in assemble form, takes 6x6 matrix, and 2-3, 2-3 will be coming in the last. So this is the tricky part that you should know. Otherwise, whatever you will pass something, and the Abacus will read in a different manner, that then you will have convergence problem. So now, whoever is dealing with rubber or any complex constitutive models, the first thing is always asked that how to identify the parameters. So usually, we go for uniaxial test, shear test, and you try to obtain the uniaxial parameter and you fit it with the model whatever you have. As you can see in this particular slide, I have tried to obtain the data. It's a Marlowe experimental data given in the Abacus examples. And then you can run with your UMAT and you can see how it closely resembles to your experimental data. So one thing you should notice that the new Hookin is very simple, but it cannot take the upward turn into the constructed model. For sure, for that you have more complex models. You can go for your model, or where you have complexity in terms of invariance, second invariance or third invariance. So there you can play along and you can try to bring all this into the constructive model. So there are other tests, biaxial and planar, and you try to fit the model with this test. Okay, now coming with the UMAT header. So I would like to explain here how the UMAT things are written. So the first thing, when you start writing that, then you have a subroutine UMAT. This is the header given by Abacus documentations, where you have to write in this format, where stress is Cauchy stress, state V is state variable. So it's like sort of array that you want to store something. Okay. DDS, DDE is the second derivative of strain energy density. So that is our tangent stiffness. SSE, SPD, SCD, these are all related to plastic dissipation or elastic energy storage. This we do not use it. So if you want to have a complex elastoplastic model, probably then you need SPD, or some creep laws, then you need SCD. And then if you want to have some thermal effect, then you can have DDS, DDT, then DR, PLD. So we will not use all these things because these are used for another complex behavior, but you have to define these variables because Abacus needs to have this. Okay, what we will use here, DF, GR, D0, which is deformation gradient at time t equals to zero. So this is at the last step, and DF, GR, D1, that is deformation gradient at current time step. So this is F tau, and F0 is nothing but the data which is in the last time step. Okay, NOEL is the number of element, NPT, I think it's a number of integration point, K step, you can see that which step that you are imposing this, K inc is the increment, N state V is the number of state variables, props, as I said, you have to define the properties. So let us say properties 1, you can call that as your Young's modulus, n props, number of properties, chords is coordinates of your continuum, and there also you should know that it could be in the current configuration or that could be static, so that does not change. Okay, d rot is the rotation. PNEWDT is with the time steps. You can control that mainly in UEL, but UMAT, I have not used it. Strain and de-strain, very, very important, very complex, these two guys, because when you change this NLGOM, which is for nonlinear calculations or finite deformation calculations, these are logarithmic strain. Remember that these are logarithmic strain. So you should check, you can print this strain and you can code it with your logarithmic strain and you can see whether it is matching or not. Okay. D strain again, in terms of when you go for finite deformation. So D strain is nothing but change in logarithmic strain. So what is the logarithmic strain at current time step? What was there in the last step? Difference of that. That is D strain. So these two are very complex quantities. Why I'm telling that? Because when you write your UEL, let us say, so there you need to define these guys in finite deformation, and there is a complexity. Because if you do not know how these are written, you will always have a problem. But in case of linear elastic, these are the nominal things. These are Lagrangian strains. So that is the complexity while dealing with Abacus internal variables. Okay, so the header is clearly defined. Now these are arrays, vectors, and stress and the tensors. So now you have to assign that stress as n-tens. N-tens could be four, let us say for plane strain. And when you go for, let us say, three-dimensional problem, then you have n-tens equals to six. So you can print these variables. When you are writing first time, you should know that what are all these variables. Now state variable, again, as I said, here you can store some of the state variables, let us say damage, what was there in the last step, and what is there in the current step, so that you can pass it through UMAT and you can visualize it in the ODB, okay? And then you know the deformation gradient is 3/3. And then D-rot is, again, rotation tensor 3/3. Coordinates of kind of 3, 1, 2, and 3. So this is needed. This you have defined. Well and good. Let us go forward. And then abaparam.ing. This is also important because then you are including the, that means you are declaring these are Abacus parametric parameters, and that you are calling this from the Abacus internal user routines. Okay. So the next part, let us say in input file, what are all the changes that you need to do? You need to define the material name, then dependent variables. So let us say I have 27 state variables. I want to plot damage in all the directions. I want to plot stress in different directions. So I have defined all those variables and I have passed 27 variables. And in my user materials, I have 5 constants. So n props is 5 for me. Props 1, props 2, props 3, props 4, and props 5. Okay. So these are dependent variables to allocate the space at each material point. Okay, so this is nothing but a part of input file. Once this is done, how you are invoking that? So you have a backup job, which is you have an input file separately, and you have user material. So you run that as a backup job input file, and user equals to UMAT, whatever name you have. Okay. Then some of the variables, this I think I have already defined, that you need to have isochoric, you need to have volumetric, that you can have in current configuration, that you can have in reference configuration, and then you can store all these variables in a state variable, and you can visualize it in ODB. Okay, so now to define that, what I have done, I have defined your Fortran routine separately, invariants, call invariants, which has separate subroutines. It takes C as an input and it gives me invariant INV1, INV2, INV3. So with these invariants, C bar I have defined as, you know, F transpose F. So F bar transpose F bar. So as you know that when we talk about rubber, we always decompose the deformation gradient into two quantities, which is one is volume preserving and one is isochoric part. So C bar is nothing but F bar transpose F bar. And with this invariance, you have obtained INV1, INV2, INV3. So in terms of mathematics for the beginners, so you know that for any matrix, you can obtain the invariants. And the same way, we have quoted it in a manner that you have three invariants, and psi iso is defined as first invariant minus 3, which is written as 3, then volumetric energy, and then you can define the strain energy, which is total isochoric plus volumetric, and then you have to define the tangent stiffness at C iso, C volume, and C jaw, which is Yeoman part of tangent stiffness. So now you are done with the part coding of the UMAT. Now what you have to check, you have to go to the message file, you have to see the residual tolerance. So Abacus, if some of you have carefully seen the message file, it reports almost everything related to convergence. So what you have to check mainly is the R max, which it reports, it follows this relation or not. Okay. Similarly, in terms of displacement correction, so residual tolerance, displacement correction control, that you can see. And you can plot, as I said, you can plot the error. Yeah, it gives you all the errors. You can plot the errors, which is over the steps, how it is changing, over the increments, over the steps. So if it is quadratic, that means you have coded very nicely. Okay, as we started with that, we want to implement our UMAT with the damage law. So in a continuum sense, so you should have some criteria that when the damage has to grow and when the damage will change. So kind of relation which needs to be defined to update the damage variable. And that follows basically Kuntaker KKT conditions. And there you can have, let us say, phi d in a strain space. So strain space means that my damage is a function of strain parameter. Could be, you can write in terms of energy also. You can write in terms of stress also. So the same way you have to take the derivative, okay? So to update the next time step, what will be my damage? Okay, so this is an algorithm. You obtain the dynamic force, thermodynamics, and then you check the damage conditions. So that means what was the damage in the last step, what is there in the current step, what is the difference. So damage should always grow or should be constant. It should not be less than my last step. So that ensures, this algorithm ensures that. So that damage has to grow or it has to be consistent, constant. Okay, it should not be less than the last step. That is the definition of damage. Okay. So now since you have an additional loss, so you have to impose additional tangent stiffness due to damage. Okay. So that you can write it in this particular format. So this, how this is derived, again, there you can follow either one of my paper, or you can follow the textbook of Hozafel. There he has given how you should write the consistent tangent stiffness for coming from the damage loss. So this is what I have adapted. So as I said in the beginning that my damage is going to affect my isochoric part. So this is what is happening here. And additional damage variables. So that you have to plug in as a if loop when the damage is growing. Otherwise you keep this guys. So when there is no change in damage, so assume that you're doing some cyclic loading sort of things. And in your particular case, assume that when you are in compression, that then there is no damage. So when you are in compression, there is no damage. That means damage is constant. So in that case, you will have this law. And when there is a tension or increasing amplitude, then you will have this guys there. So that's it. So you have defined all the parameters. Everything is set. With the modification of hyperelastic law for a damage, particular isotropic continuum damage model. So this is one simple example. What I have tried to demonstrate here, you have a classical plate with a hole, and a plate with the hole, you have pulling it, let us say in y direction, and you plot 1 minus d. So you can see damage is concentrating here. So I think most of you, if you have done the linear strain analysis or linear fracture mechanics, you always see that the crack growth, or you can say the concentration of stress, always happens in the notch where the end of your circular hole, right? So this is what is demonstrated for isotropic damage hyperelastic sense. And then you can plot the reaction force versus displacement as you can call as a load displacement. Let us say you can record that at some of the point where you are applying the load, and you can see what is happening. You can also plot with damage, without damage. So without damage, you should expect your curve to go higher. So maybe I should draw this, let us say, if this has to go without damage, it will go above this curve, okay? So with damage, of course, your stress has reduced, and that is why the resultant reaction force is less. So this, you can plot it either with the cyclic loading, either with the amplitude change loading, or whatever loading that you have, because now your UMAT has all the features to control this variable. Okay, I think I need to. Okay. Now, there is also a problem. So now you are imposing the damage loss. So there is a problem that when damage reaches one, what happens when damage reaches one? So you have implemented that routine as 1 minus d of stress. So imagine that when damage is one in one of the element, what will happen? The stress will be zero. So when stress will be zero, again, your convergence will be poor, because then you cannot load the material, particularly for that case. Okay, so then what you have to do, there is a trick. This is the simplest trick in UMAT, but in UEL there are a lot of options. Like, you can regularize this damage model with gradient law, that you can refer one of the paper from me, how to regularize these damage variables. So but for UMAT, what we do, we regularize with viscous variable eta. Okay, and this eta is one thing which does not allow damage to be one. So imagine that you have this variable in such a manner that it does not allow damage to reach one, but it is like 0.99, something like that, so that you can converge your problem. Okay, this is a trick. It can give you some unwanted result, but there is no other way. This is what you have to do. Otherwise, your material will not converge. So now let us say you refine the mesh to greater extent. Let us say mesh one, you can see it's a coarser. Then you go finer and finer, and you can converge those problems with this regularization. What I said, this is called viscous regularization. And you can see further refine, but still you are able to do that. This is only because of your regularization. Otherwise, this problem will not converge. Okay, now something that you can always do with the input file, you can write that as parametric input file. That is a nice feature in Abacus. And there you can control a lot of things. So here I have just tried to show that you have a radius, T1 is the thickness of your plate. And then you have to define in this manner by, if I don't know, if some of you have coded already the element connectivity or type of R theta coordinate system, cylindrical coordinate system, then you might be knowing that this is how you are calling the nodes and trying to generate a mesh with these nodes. So engine is the node generation in a particular fashion. Then you define the set, node set, and then you fill this complete zone with nodes. And then once this is there, then you have to generate the element. So with LGen, you can generate the element. Once you have element generated, then you can define the element set, and then you can call that as plate, and then your input file is complete. Then you have to define the particular step size. So whether you want to go with Newton-Raphson, arc length method, or it's a static, it's a dynamic, quasi-static, what type of solver that you are using. And then boundary condition, that's it. So this particular feature that you can use it just to generate the model. Why I'm saying that, but some of you are, let us say, a master student or PhD student, they want to have several files. So with this input parametric input file, you can generate a lot of files just by changing these variables. So you don't need to save all the input files. Just keep this in front, just change these variables, and you will have different mesh types. Okay, so that's it. So what we talked about today, we talked about everything is local. So this continuum calculation and everything is local and damage mechanics. So you can enhance this local damage mechanics to non-local damage mechanics. And there comes the fracture mechanics and gradient enhanced damage models. For that, you have to go for user element, not the user material, because there you need to write the coordinates, you need to define your deformation gradient, then you have to define another variable in the same nodes. So apart from displacement, there will be another scalar variable. Let us call that as a non-local damage variable. And then you have to define proper interpolation functions between these guys. And you have to code it as a coupled thermomechanical or displacement damage trace. So once you have coded everything, and then that we will not discuss today. So there is the local to non-local, and then there are some formulations on that. Let us not go into these things because this is a part of your UEL. So I thank you all for the lecture part. So let us take 5 minutes break, and then we'll start again for the user material. I will demonstrate with the user material file that what you have to check and how to run. So, and then we will finish this lecture. And regarding the contents, I will share some of them to Ajay, and Ajay will be sharing these things to you via some network, or Ajay might be doing that. So Ajay, so let us take 5-10 minutes break, and then I think we should go for this Abacus things. What do you say?
Sure, Neeraj, that sounds good to me. With regard to the materials, everything that Neeraj would share with me, I would be sharing through a cloud. I would be sending you the link for those who are registered and participating. I would be sending you, you'll be getting the link to your email. And those who are already in the class, I think you have we have a way of sharing things, and I think that would work in there, right? So with regard to sharing, I think that should not be a concern. Yeah, we can take a 5-minute break and then we can, I think, start again.
Right. Yeah, there is one question I see in the chat box. Santanu has posted. So yeah. I assume that size specifically for polymers may affect. Yeah, that's right. As I said, yes, that depends on whatever you are choosing. So you can impose your damage law to volumetric part as well.
Yeah, I mean, actually, there are several questions. I've collected them. Some of them are theoretical. Some of them are related to your code. Maybe, I mean, it could be because you've been also speaking for an hour now. Maybe you can take a 5-10 minute break. and then we can start, and maybe we can have a more discussion session once you finish showing the code, I think.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, that's a good question, Ramesh. I would add it to the list, and maybe we can come back to it if it would be okay for you.
Yeah, so let us meet around 10:05, okay?
Okay,
and
sounds
then we
good
will,
to me.
We will take questions and also we will demonstrate.
Sounds good. Okay? Okay, fine, sounds good.
Okay then.
Thanks, Nirav.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, so we will be running one example plate with the hole, the quarter cut of that plate. And I will be showing you some of the variables that how you should plot this. Okay, so I think you can see my screen, right?
Yeah, we can see the screen. It looks good.
I will zoom it a little bit. Previous one was better. Okay, so this is an input file. Okay, you keep everything at the same place. So you have an input file and you have a UMAT. So in the same place you should put it, and then as I said, you go to the power cell and then you can run this job. As Rebecca's job equals to the name of the model. So it is running the job. And then you can open the ODB. Let us say so this is a model. As I said, you can generate a parametric file and you can play with the thickness and the model size. So this is what we are doing in this particular case. We are loading and unloading. Okay. And stress is fawn misses stress. And there are several SDVs. So as I showed in my slide, these are dependent variables that you can control it. That is the control, it is in your hand how to control that. And the loading and everything, you can define it in input file. So you can have amplitude file. As you know that in Abacus, you can embed the different sort of amplitude, periodic amplitude or a ramp function or whatever. You can see that in the input file generation. So I will show you now input UMAT so that we can see some of the variables. So Notepad++ is a very good editor. So those who are new to this, you should install this. Okay, so let us try to understand quickly that what is happening here. So first you have to define the header. As I said, this is a header. Okay, and then this is a standard Abacus things. And then whatever variable you define, you can define the stress as a matrix or as a vector, but then you have to convert it later on as a vector. And then some of the damage variables that I have defined it here. Time 1 equals to 0, I say that my state variable is 0. And you see here also that 0 and everything I have defined as a parameter. So 0, 1, 2, 3. So that you can write it like this way. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. So this is my state variable. Now, it's a procedure. As you know that I'm doing it new Hookian. So I call this where I have defined my tangent stiffness, where I have defined my stress. Okay. So this is my main routine here. So let us go there. So it is a subroutine for new Hookian. Why I have made it like that? Because now if I write it for new Hookian or if I write it for Ogden, I don't need to change my main routine. So my main routine will be the same. I will be just calling the integration procedure different. So I will be calling my new Hookian or Muniravling. So I will be calling only this guy, but my main body will be the same, right? Okay, so let us look at some of the variable. So identity matrix, as I said, you need to define identity matrix, and then you have to define the fourth order tensor, which is capital I, if you remember. Then you have to find the deformation of determinant, which is nothing but determinant of F. And then you have to decompose the deformation gradient into two parts, which is F to the power minus 1 by 3, and the other part. So F equals to F isochoric times F volumetric. So volume preserving and isochoric part. Then you define F bar, which is a scale, which is this guy, times deformation gradient DF GRD1. So because this is the deformation gradient at time, current time step, presently at now, okay? B bar is your strain tensor, which is in, again, in the current configuration. That to define as F transpose, then C bar, F transpose F. Then you have to define DW, DE bar is nothing but the derivative of free energy with respect to E. E is Lagrange strain. So this is the derivative. Then you have to take the derivative of volumetric energy with, if you remember my slides, d psi by dj or d2 psi by dj2. If you remember that we have a slide called invariance. In the slide, there you need to compute the invariant 1, 2, and 3. And with that, you can define your free energy, isochoric part and volumetric part. Then you can impose the kappa, which is the damage, as 1 minus eta d into kappa d minus kappa. Kappa d is nothing but, again, in this case, is a constitutive parameter. Now you start defining the stress, which is F bar. If you remember, I told you that we have F as F transpose, where S is nothing but your second Piola stress, right? So this is what we are doing. We are doing is F, S, F transpose. This is my stress, and with that I define my Kirchhoff stress and Cauchy stress. And then what I do, I define my CISO. If you remember that, I need to define CISO, and then I need to define C volumetric, and then I need to define C yaw for Yaumann stiffness. Once all the stiffness is defined, then you need to assemble it for if loop. If you remember that, to understand that whether the damage is growing or not. Once this is done, you are done with this integration procedure. So once you are done with this integration procedure, then go back to this guy. So line number 44. So here you have called all these properties. And then, as I said, Abacus demands just stresses in a vector sense. So then you have to store these guys in a vector sense. So because now sigma was in a matrix, you store that in a vector and update the tangent stiffness, DDS, DDE, in a 6x6 matrix. So now we have, you can see here, now we have written it in a manner 3, 3, 3, 3. Okay, because it is easy to write, it is easy to multiply and get this 4x4, this fourth order tensor. Okay, convert that into the 6x6, pass it to the UMAT, that's it, you are done. So that is the most simplest UMAT for new Hokkien. But of course, you can bring many physics into that by implementing damage, by implementing viscoelasticity, by bringing the thermal strains. So you can do everything. Now, as an exercise, I would suggest you what you should do, and maybe you can discuss with me or Ajay. You try to obtain a strain, okay? You try to obtain strain from your law. So simply you can, let us say, I have defined E as my Lagrange strain, 0.5, let us say, you can use the inbuilt matmul, which is for matrix multiplication. So let us say I have F transpose F, this I have defined. Now I want to see, I mean, what is this E Lagrangian, let us say. Okay, so let us say I want to see the component of E Lagrange. So E lag, let us say 1, 1. So the best thing, the way I learned this programming, that if you do not understand anything, you just print it. Okay, you just print it. So you will see whether the variables are changing or not. If it is changing, how it is changing. Otherwise, you can store this into the variables and then plot those variables. So let us say print this guy. So we will go the same manner here.
Neeraj, is there a minus one that we might be missing somewhere in the Lagrange strain?
Identity tensor, I missed that. So okay, I just wanted to show that, but identity tensor, I guess I have called it somewhere up.
Okay, no issue, just.
I purposefully I missed that. So now you can see here what is happening. So you see that it says that the shapes of the array is not defined. Something is missing. You can see here because one bracket is missed. Okay, so let us say you add this bracket. So now you see something is again missing. That means E lag, because I have not defined this variable, so it will not print it, right? So you have to define this. This first important thing, whatever variables you are declaring in your UMAT, you have to define it with the proper dimension. So you can see here, I'm calling 3x3, it's 3x3. So F transpose F, so this should be 3x3. Okay, so let us say I define it. Now I think it should read, hope so. So now it is reading, it means everything is gone correctly into the UMAT. And now we have this variable ELAG. Because I is missing, I will not call as a strain. But you can plot this way, okay? You can see it's 0.5 always. So you can see what is happening. This is, I mean, just now it started changing to 0.49. So you can plot all this, okay? So that is the thing. I mean, whatever variables that you have defined clearly, you have to store that in a state variable or print it and see what how it is changing with respect to the time. Fine. So this is a thing with respect to UMAT. I will be saying that, so you will be getting it, and you have to practice on your own, and you should define your own variable rather than going with my variables. You can define it in your own variables and print those variables, store in the array, and see what is happening in the UMAT ODB, right? So you have everything here, and you can plot the pawn missile stress, let us say. And let us say if you want to see what is happening in this particular element, you can take that element and you can select that pawn missile integration point. So this is the continuum element, 8 node integrated. So let us plot it at all then, or you can do the centroid. So it will take average the data at the centroid. We will have only one plot instead of 8 plots. Okay, so let us select this. So this is my cyclic loading, and this is how it goes, and then here I am trying to stop it purposefully. So the stress is increasing, then you unload it, decreasing, then you increase the amplitude, increasing, and then it stops here. So now we can go for the question. These materials will be shared to you, so you should not worry about this. So I will customize, I will remove some part, because this will be specific to my thesis and other things. But you should be able to invoke the damage laws or the dependency, as I said, in the stress dependency on other parameters or a strain that you want to go for, Almansi strain, Lagrange strain, logarithmic strain. My recommendation to the beginners would be, first you define all the continuum variables in reference configuration and current configuration. Try to plot these guys. So try to plot the second Piola, first Piola, Cauchy stress, then strains in the reference configuration, your right Cauchy, and then move that to current. Then you have Euler-Almansi strain, then left Cauchy-Green strain tensor, and you see what are the differences between these strains. So when the deformation is happening, what is happening with these strains and these quantities? Then probably you will be able to connect with these user routines. Okay, now we can take questions, Ajay, and then regarding the installation, I will give some comments. See, this. I have some links that also I will be sharing with you, that links tell you that how you should install the Fortran in Abacus. So you have to define some environment variables. I don't know how you are using your Abacus, whether it is in Linux configuration or it is in Windows configuration. In Windows, it is always a problem. But in Linux, and the set of lines are already defined. But of course, you should follow these steps. This is written by, I hope you know, as a guy who runs this website, Polymer Frame by Jorgen. And the steps I will be sharing with you. I will be giving this to Ajay, and Ajay will be sharing with you. Follow those steps to install Fortran environment variables with Abacus. Then only you will be able to run Abacus input file with UMAT. And now we can take some questions, and then we can close it in some minutes.
Hey, Neeraj, thank you very much for. Would it be possible to I think there's also Shashi, I think, already posted it as well. Would it be possible to just maybe show the steps that are there involved in configuring the Fortran compiler? Maybe we can just limit it to Windows for now, I think, because most of the users are in Windows. Somebody has to work in Linux, maybe they can probably come back to us, and maybe we can help them. If it's possible to maybe share the document and screen share, and if we can go through it in a couple of minutes, that could be helpful.
I'm just trying to find out that Jorgen post.
Okay. Sure. In the meantime, maybe we can also look at some of the other things. I think Shantanu had some very nice questions. Maybe I can give him the floor. Maybe he can ask them, I think, instead of me taking his questions right now. Professor Shantanu, would you want to like go ahead?
One minute, let me just check what were the questions.
Sure. I think first one, please go ahead. Maybe. Do you want me to share it with you?
Yeah, that will be good. Sorry.
Yeah, let me share.
Sorry. Yeah, I got it. So, as the first question, you already answered, because the free energy expression that is given, that is specifically applicable to the polymer kind of materials. So you already answered that question, so no problem with that. So that why the Jaumann rate was added, can you please explain that, because I'm not sure if I could able to catch it. So you said that for the quadratic convergence, but is that the only reason? What if I don't add the Jaumann rate, what will happen? Because I'm not sure if the Jaumann rate naturally comes from your derivation of the stress, right?
You want to answer me? I can answer. You want me to answer this?
Anybody can answer. Because Jaumann rate usually comes from the objectivity point of view or frame indifference and those things. So I was thinking, is there any such connection that our...
Actually, I can tell you with the, I mean, I can frame that with reference to the Abaqel documentation, because what they have quoted there, that
okay,
increases
okay.
the convergence in the, that enhances the convergence in the model. So you can try this UMAT. I will send you the UMAT. You can try without adding the Jaumann. But that will be slow. Okay.
So it will take more number of inner iterations probably.
Probably, and it will be linear also. To make it quadratic, they are adding it. So that is the internal thing.
Okay.
So another
question. So but they have not given any derivation or something like that?
Derivation, you can find it in the textbook.
That
I have followed it, that I can give you the reference. It's even in the CIMU also, computational inelasticity by CIMU.
Okay.
Is it possible to share the presentation of the part? I can share you some part of it. Which is important for coding UMAT. I can share it to you. That is no problem. Your fourth question is.
So that question is okay, because you are already showing that you are eventually storing DDSDD as a second order tensor, like in the kind of in a Weig notation. So that question is already answered. So in the damage evolution, you had to use that viscous regularization because there is a possibility of damage variable reaching one.
Right.
So instead of damage evolution, if I just do the explicit damage, like using exponential function or some such function, that is never going to reach one. Then in that case, can I get rid of? Then we don't need, right? Okay.
Yeah, you don't need that.
Okay. So only when there is a possibility of damage approaching one, we need some kind of regularization technique. Otherwise, it is not required. Okay.
So why I introduce that? Because there is a motivation behind it. You see, in my last slide, in my PhD, I moved from local to non-local continuum. So the concept of fracture mechanics and this phase field model and the gradient damage model, that is popular because that can be used for a continuum where you can go with damage one. So damage will not be localized. Damage will be spread throughout the continuum.
Correct.
Yeah. So that is the reason of that.
Okay. So just one last question. Yeah. That strain variable, that STRAN, maybe I missed something. That only when the NL JOM is on, the strain variable will have a logarithmic strain, right?
Right, that is right.
So if the NL JOM is off, then it will have engineering strain or Cauchy strain. I mean,
that is a Lagrange strain. Again, there is a thing for one two component, then you have to multiply with two times. I mean, 1, 2, 1, 3 and 2, 3.
So essentially, the engineering strain. So that would be the like the engineering strains, right?
That will be in small deformation engineering strains, right?
Right.
Okay.
That is very typical in a bucket. So if someone doesn't know that, he will have lot of problems, because I initially had a problem with NL geom, because usually when you print this strain, it's a logarithmic nature.
Yeah, because that NL JOM kind of is bit odd, because sometimes when I was not expecting, I used to get the expected values using NL JOM on. Even if I have just a uniaxial tension kind of situation, very, very simple situation. And there it was like running some RV homogenization in the UMAT. And I was a bit surprised, because there was no reason for NL JOM to be on, because it was a small deformation. And like a usual situation, but that NL JOM is a bit, I don't know. I mean, when it should be on and when it should be off. Because
that is geometrical nonlinearity. When you expect that your deformation is large, so there you want to choose deformation gradient.
I have a very simple situation, just a rectangular box with a very, very small deformation being applied. Only difference was that there was some homogenization operation going on in the UMAT.
Okay.
So, computed stress strain plot was not matching with the analytical values, because the homogenized result, I was expecting it to follow a linear elastic Hooke's law. But only after I switched on NL JOM on, then it started matching. That was a bit weird for me, because I was hoping that NL JOM will not play any role, but it looks like internally it does play sometimes significant role probably.
Yeah, there are actually a lot of hidden things. I don't know. I'm stuck in something since last few weeks for an elastoplastic model. And I'm quoting some length scale dependent elastoplastic law in finite deformation. So, as I have shown that in UMAT, you have a D rot. So, D rot is a rotation matrix that is provided by UMAT. But when you write user element, then you don't have access to D rot. So, I'm trying to code D rot since last 1 month. I'm not able to successfully compile that. So, something is hidden that it's very difficult to match with a bucket. So you never know what is going behind that. So life is much complicated when you code the elastoplastic thing, or when you have a thermal dependency, because some of your strain will be subtracted, and then you don't know how it is subtracted and how these relations are amplified in UMAT. So,
Correct.
So that is why I always recommend to go for UMAT, but sometimes there is no choice. You have to go for UEL.
Okay. Thanks a lot. That's all from me.
Yeah, no problem. Thank you.
Thanks, Shantanu, for the very nice questions. I think Ramesh had a couple of questions. Maybe Ramesh could, if you would like to take over.
I can read that question. Seventh question, right?
So there are two questions from Professor Ramesh. One is, can you describe, seventh one was one. And I think sixth one was also from him. Can you describe more about regularization? Maybe he can elaborate on what he would like to know there. I think the slightly open-ended question in there, so maybe he can elaborate on it. But I think probably the seventh one is probably a little more straightforward, orthotropic hyperelastic model. Maybe you can have an idea and give an idea about that.
Yeah, I have coded anisotropic hyperelastic material in UMAT. That is definitely possible. So I think orthotropics would also be possible. So in that case, mainly that you have to define the directions. Then you have to bring the orientation somehow into your UMAT, probably. And I think this card is possible to access. So I guess this is possible. I have not coded orthotropic hyperelastic, but I can definitely say I have coded anisotropic hyperelastic. That is definitely possible for Holzhafer material model, for example.
Neeraj, I just want to know, you have a combination of cards and a matrix together. Is it a homogenized model that we are going to model in UMAT, or we can model individual matrix and fiber level, that is at micromechanics level, we can model and then take it forward to continuum level? So that was one more question I thought of asking.
Yeah, very good question. So in Abacus, if I talk about from Abacus point of view, there is a modeling technique which they call a submodel technique. So you have a 3D calculation which is homogenized sense, where you do not see the actual geometry of the cords. But let us say in a particular zone you want to understand what is the failure mechanism, then you derive the submodels. And in these submodels, you have a dimension of cords and rubber matrix. So basically, from my perspective, you should use UMAT for individual materials in submodel scale, where the length scale that you can see the cords. So that would be my answer to your question. Yeah.
Okay, very good. Thank you. One more is when you are mentioning about convergence and what is the basis for this regularization scheme? Is there any a mathematical basis, or is it a ad hoc kind of implementation?
There is, for viscous regularization, there is no basis, but it's only to converge the solution. But for gradient damage, yeah, there is a basis that you do not want your damage to localize in a particular element. So assume that you have a plate with a hole and you know that crack is already initiated. So you want that crack to grow. It should not be arrested, particularly at that element. So for that sort of modeling, you use gradient enhanced damage model or any phase fill sort of model. So that is the basis for in terms of C0 continuum or C1 continuum gradient damage model. But for viscous, I think there is no mathematics behind it. It's just for enhancing the convergence. This is what I understand.
Okay. Could it be possible to send some kind of a documentation or some kind of a mathematical rigorous what is involved for even that local UMAT as well as for sub UMAT kind of one, as well as for this regularization? Is it possible, Neeraj?
Yeah, I can send you the slide snipping. I can send you. No problem.
Okay. So, thanks.
I will be sharing to Ajay, and Ajay will be sharing to him.
Yeah, that's great.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm still in search of that link, but so far I didn't find it. But anyways, I will be sharing that link also.
So okay.
Give me 2-3 minutes more. If I find it, then I can explain it to you how you can link Fortran with Abacus.
Sure. In the meantime, just maybe I can add into what Ramesh was asking. I remember that you had done with this anisotropic model with fiber, right? I mean, you had these fiber orientations and things. Are you trying to implement something like that with Bacchus? Or?
Yeah, that's true.
I remember having seen that from your thesis.
Yeah.
I think that you can directly incorporate some of the material properties itself, right? Because you have an input of the fiber orientation, which is coming in. And so then you're kind of using taking a dyadic product to create some kind of a tensor from the vector, right?
That's true. But when it comes to the, let's say, if you look at the psi, what he showed in the beginning, the strain energy, which is a three-dimensional energy, looking at a continuum level.
Correct.
But can we look at the strain energy at fiber and a matrix combination level? And then take it forward, the material properties from here to the continuum level. And then we can combine, or we can connect a link between this micromechanics level to continuum level. And then modeling at that level, finding a new constitutive law, which is at continuum level. That is where UMAT will get into picture. Now, my thought was like, can we, let's say length scale is down, but can we do the same thing at micro scale level, get the constitutive law, get the stresses, get the strains, and put it in the 3D strain energy expression?
I think that is technically possible. Like I think what Neeraj has done here is he has the strain energy density, has taken the derivative to get the stresses and the tangent. So instead of we doing that, we can probably call another Fortran routine or something, let's say another function, where it is going to calculate for the RVE. I think that is technically possible there. So you calculate for the RVE, then you have to do the homogenization standard things and get the average stress and average material tangent and pass it back. I think this is definitely possible, but I'm not sure on the computational complexity of it. How much time it would take?
Dr. Ajay, can I please add something over here?
Yes, definitely.
Hello, Dr. Ramesh. Your question is very interesting. And something similar that I have done, that I, in my UMAT, I was going at the micro scale level. I was looking at individual warp and field direction plies of textile composite. Then I was computing the micro scale, let us not call it the micro scale, but mesoscale. So mesoscale stresses I was computing in a warp and field ply. I was homogenizing them to get a macro scale stress at that one particular Gauss point. So fundamentally, I am assuming a certain RVE at every Gauss point. And then I keep on going from macro scale strain, going to the mesoscale stresses, again coming back to the macro scale stresses. And that works really well as long as there is a homogeneous deformation, which means that in your model, there is no notch or something. And as Dr. Ajay pointed out, that it is computationally intensive. It takes a lot of time for convergence. But the moment there is a notch or something, Abacus has a lot of issues because there is a stress concentration ahead of the tip of the notch. And it creates a lot of convergence problems. And on the top, if you incorporate the damage, it becomes much worse. It doesn't even work if you correctly derive the tangent modulus. Till you reach the ultimate point in your stress strain diagram, even if you approximate your second matrix as a tangent matrix, still it works. It takes quite a lot of time, but still it works. But the moment it crosses, or it is trying to cross the point of inflation, it cannot go further. Even if you have a very rigorous derivation of consistent tangent modulus where it will become negative beyond the point of inflation, still it goes up to the sum iterations, and beyond that it just simply gives up and it says that negative eigenvalues and God knows what are the other errors, and it eventually gives up. So it becomes very, very tough. Like as you mentioned, that if you keep on going between the different length scale within the UMAT, beyond certain limit, Abacus gives up. I mean, that's what my observation is.
Yeah. So just one thing I can add there is, you can, that's exactly, that's the one of the, Shashi also probably wants to add something there. One thing that I would say is, as long as you don't have any localizations, these localizations could be in the form of damage, fracture, buckling, any of these things, you can do this micro-macro thing, right? The first order homogenization. But once you have some kind of a localization, then probably the best way to look at it is like a second order gradient methods. So essentially there you're not just looking at imposing the deformation gradient, but you're also looking at imposing like the gradient of the deformation gradient. So I think these have shown to be reasonably good, especially when you have localizations and damage. There are quite some papers very early in 2000s by Pedro Ponte, Castaneda, and all of these guys who are like core homogenization guys. Maybe I can share some papers because I was recently doing a review for a journal on the same topic. I think there's a lot of work in there. So if, for example, if you want to add in some localization, then I think first order methods will not work anymore. You probably have.
Yeah, you're correct. You're correct, Dr. Ajay. So this is what I was going. That once you want to do that non-localization and other models, you will have to move out of Abaqus and then start developing your own code, because Abaqus doesn't give you access to other Gauss points information, and lot of these techniques will require the values at the nearby Gauss points. So some workaround you will have to do by using some. Using the values from the previous iteration and something like that to get around it. But as you said that when you go to higher order these theories, Abaqus, according to my observation, is not really useful. But developing your own code is the only solution. For example, if you look at the groups of this Professor René de Bors and Varsul, they have like legendary codes which have been developed like over the so many years, and they do all kinds of homogenization, this adhesive bonding, cohesive bonding and all that, and they actually do much more computational intensive, which means that they solve a boundary value problem at the micro scale level. So that is probably, I cannot even think of doing it using Abaqus because it will simply give up. We should not say we couldn't do that, but let us say that everything has its own applicability, and we should exploit that. That is the best way to look at it. Yeah. Thanks.
I think Shashi wanted to add something in there. Probably we can give him a floor. Hey, Shashi, do you want to add something?
Hi, Ajay. Actually, Neeraj, thank you very much for a very nice presentation. It's really good.
Thank you.
So what I want to add on here is, the RV approach is basically based on the understanding that RV is the homogeneous block of that element. Right? It's the repeatable block of that material, where you are actually modeling what is happening inside that micromechanics inside. So, now, when you have a non-homogeneous thing like a crack or a buckling kind of initiation, your RVE is lost already at that point. The RVE is not sufficient to represent. It's a representative volume element, right? So it is not actually representing what is happening there. So you cannot use it fundamentally. So you have already told that in a different way, so that I wanted to add. So the moment RVG deviates from its basic function, I think the idea is lost there.
Okay. Yeah, I agree with what Shashi is saying, but just to add, elaborate on that. The whole idea when people started doing these micromechanical models, if I understand, was to, if you look at finite element, it was started by civil engineers and aeronautics engineers, where they wanted to think about large structures. And very few people realize that the biggest, for example, if you're doing a crack propagation, if you look at most of, let's say 99.99%, I can say, of the papers, they will always assume that there's a crack existing, right? You'll hardly find papers who are talking about initiating a crack and letting it run, right? So there's always a crack existing in there. To some extent, it is also correct, because when you're doing manufacturing, probably there's a lot of defects that come into picture, which will probably induce some micro cracks and things like that. So people realize that the biggest issue there was not just the computational problem, but also to understand the material properties itself. Because if we take an elastic material, we say Young's modulus and Poisson ratio is sufficient, right? But at the end of the day, they're not sufficient to create a crack and, to kind of initiate it. So that's where people started to go deeper into the material, especially, for example, if you're doing a forming process. Depending on the crystal structure, it can be quite different of how, and kind of, quite complicated things happening at the micro scale. So that's where the whole micro-macro thing started out, I would say, if I understand correctly. Maybe I'm kind of generalizing it a little bit. But now then again, like, you know, people wanted to look at cracks, right? So that was where they built a traditional let's say definition of what an RVE should be. But now kind of, let's say, if we look at different kinds of things that are coming out, we wanted to somehow, I think people wanted to see, hey, if there's a damage at RV, how do I take it to the macro scale? You know, maybe not all the RVs are damaged. Maybe one of them is we consider with a damage, one we consider without a damage, right? So in a way, kind of what would happen if there's a damage at the micro scale? How would it translate to the macro scale? That's the whole idea you want to physically understand, right? Because most of these damages start, like cracks start at the micro scale, but then eventually you see that it becomes a macro crack. So how does this transition happen is always a big question. How does damage or fracture happen in a way? And I think that's where kind of they want, the idea was to extend the idea of an RV itself, where you can have damage and localizations. So of course, it's a slightly complicated thing to wrap around, because one can always say, okay, hey, not every unit might have a damage, right? So it might not be a repeating unit as well. But just to add into what also Shantanu was saying, is yes, I mean, computationally, it's very intense. If you want to do what you're looking at is like something called a concurrent multi-scaling. So at every Gauss point, you go in and do a micromechanical calculation, come back and do things. There's all the other thing that most people are doing is what we call as a sequential multi-scaling. You take different kinds of, let's say, RVs, and try to do a lot of tests, get a lot of data, and kind of fit a function to it. This is essentially what people with machine learning are doing today, right? I mean, the fancy thing, we used to call it curve fitting, now they call it machine learning, right? I mean, at the end of the day, essentially you're fitting a function in there. Of course, with machine learning algorithms, you have like some kind of you're not fitting a function, but then you're fitting like a function with like what are the range of functions that could be possible for some behavior like this. So that is essentially kind of where it becomes more and more complicated. And I think doing anything of this kind of multi-scaling with any MATLAB code, Abacus, again, like it doesn't scale very well. Like once you have a few processors, after that, the scaling behavior is not that great. So where people kind of eventually move into some kind of a custom code of their own. Up to some point, it is good. But if you want to kind of solve a micro problem, macro problem, you probably have to have a C++ or a C or a Fortran code of your own that you can work with. For example, you can also look at, like, for example, codes like, you don't have to really develop yourself. There are a lot of code bases that have come up now, like called MFEM. That is kind of very good, especially like I think the question you're asking is thermo-electromechanical coupling. You can look at the MFEM library, which is very nice, where it is kind of particularly for the multi-physics problem, they've developed like a C++ library or C++ code that could work in there. Like, for example, FEEP is a very, very traditional old code from Berkeley that was primarily meant to develop elements. I think it's, I do not want to say it's reaching the end of its life, but I think it can, it needs to be improved quite a bit significantly to take it to the next phase. It's also good code that one can use in a way. So a lot of these open source code that one could start out with to have a look at rather than trying to start developing their own code if you have not done it before. But that would be the way to go if you want to do any kind of concurrent multi-scaling is my opinion. That's a good question. Can we model thermo-electromechanical multi-physics models, right? So I think the best way for doing something like that would be to go through a UEL solution. Maybe Neeraj can elaborate on it. But at least in my opinion, yeah. I think UMAT is not the best solution for that. UEL would be the way to go there.
Yeah, the best would be because if you have thermal degree of freedom, let us say at each node, or you have electrical degree of freedom, then UEL is the only solution. So there are some complex UEL developed by some of the people that you can refer to. I can tell you Son H. Chester or the group of MIT by Professor Anand Kumar. So you can refer some of his UEL. Yeah.
Could you please send some references or the papers or resources?
Yeah, sure. We can send it.
Thanks a lot.
So regarding the UMAT, the Fortran and Abacus environment variable, I found some link. So I will share that. Probably you should follow the same steps, I would say, but I don't know whether that will work or not.
I'll try.
Yeah, I'm just sharing it, okay?
Yeah.
Yeah, so this is one of the posts in ResearchKit. So they are saying that first of all, there should be Visual Studio 2012. So again, it depends on version to version, which version of Abacus you are using. I guess for 2014 or 2018, 2012 will work. Okay. And the thing is, like, you have to modify the environment variable going into the environment file and add this iFortvars.bat. Okay. You can see the step number 2. And then where your Abacus icon is there you can modify it. You have to add again this iFortvars. And again, going into the program files, as I said, you need to add this Intel 64. I'm not sure this will work or not, but I will be sharing some of the steps. I couldn't find more now, but as soon as I find it, I'll send it to Ajay. And there are proper steps already defined. So the first thing, what I remember, that you should have Visual Studio installed in your laptop, and you should have Fortran compiler. They should be compatible with the Abacus version that you are using, and then you should have all this batch file to be integrated in your environment file. And then if you verify all this, then you should be able to get that the user subroutine pass. So if that is passed, that means all these files are communicating to each other, and then you are successfully you have installed your Fortran and Visual Studio with Abacus. But this is very tricky because version to version it changes. That is the problem. And sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work. But I will find some better documentation on this. I remember I had that one link, and with that only I installed 2-3 times in my different laptop. But right now I'm not able to locate that. So as soon as I have that, I'll share it to Ajay and then you'll get it.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. So Ajay,
yeah.
So now, I mean, what I will do, I will be sharing a few things to you.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe you are already in discussion with all these participants, then you can share to them. And if they need anything, you can tell me, and then sure. I'll send it to you again.
Sure.
Yeah. And yeah. If in between, if they have any questions, again, then we are open to discuss always.
Yeah. Sure, that sounds good to me, Neeraj. Thank you very much. So whatever you would be sharing, I would kind of, I already kind of compiled some of these things, all the questions that were asked today, and I've added, created a Word document which I'll be sharing with all the participants as well. So thank you very much for joining today. Are there any questions, further questions? Or if not, maybe we can start end the session here.
A general question. I mean,
yes,
what is the contact if I want to make with Neeraj? Is there any possibility?
I can share my email ID. You can
write it. Sure.
So I can also add that into the. I have his email ID. Maybe I don't know. I will ask him what email ID to share. I can also put it into it, and I can share it with him. Share it with everybody as well. So we have everything in one place as well, right? So, yeah. So I think you already also put it. Yeah, so I can do that. Right. So, yeah. So if there are no other questions, I would probably end the session here today. I would thank firstly our speaker for joining, and Neeraj for taking all the time out of his schedule to really give a nice talk and help everyone here to understand how a UMAT is working and what are the intricacies involved in there, right? And also I would thank also everybody who asked questions. I think that's also a very important part of our discussion. Without these questions, it wouldn't make a complete discussion in there. I mean, the lecture is never complete without some questions coming out of it. So I would also thank all of you for asking questions and bringing and making it a very nice discussion. I hope it was very helpful. Thanks everybody for joining in. And I think it was Saturday morning. You have taken time to wake up and, you know, join in. That's already pretty great, I would say. Sorry for the one thing I would apologize is for the sound that was there. I later realized how to mute it out. But at the end of the day, unless we restart the meeting, it won't take into effect. But I hope next time we would probably not have this chime sound when somebody comes and goes out. But that apart, I hope all of you enjoyed it. I've shared the link for the feedback form. Please kindly fill it up, and I would also be sharing it again in the email. Please kindly fill it, so that way we have the, we can get some feedback from you as to like what we can do better next time, right? So there's always something that's that can be improved, and I would like you to please kind of give a feedback on it. And it's also, I think, a good feedback for Neeraj on how his lecture was and what he can improve upon it. And we always kind of want to make it better there, right? So thank you very much.